Okay, politicians talk all the time. Today is not for us to talk, it's for you to talk. It's your opportunity to tell us what's on your mind, tell us what you like, what you would like us to take a look at. We go into session on the 7th, or rather on the 12th.
Is that right?
11th. The 11th of January. We're down there to the 25th of February. And for those of you who are able to drive down and visit us, believe me, we really appreciate it. It's always good to see someone from home down in Richmond. You don't have to spend 45 days with 140 politicians. You really want to meet some nice people to come visit us. So we hope that you will consider doing that in the course of the session. Okay, here are the rules. The speakers will speak in the order in which they've signed up. If people have come in late, then we'll get them added to the list. We're going till 5 o'clock. At least I'm going till 5 o'clock because my grandkids are going to be at the house, and you guys understand what that means, right? So in any case, we're going to ask you to focus your remarks around 3 minutes. There's going to be a little light here at the podium. Just come up to the podium. It'll be green for the first 2 minutes. Then we'll go to amber, and then when it goes to red, then you're done. And we want to try to observe that, and so that everyone here has an opportunity to speak. Now, if someone has said something in detail that is exactly what you were going to say, then feel free to say, that person said it so well, I just simply like to echo that person's remarks, and then we'll get it, okay? We have a saying in Richmond that when politicians are debating and talking on the floor, they say, well, it's all been said, but it hasn't been said by all of us. So in the interest of time, to make sure that everybody gets a chance to be heard, if you're just being redundant, then feel free to truncate your remarks. But you have your 3 minutes, so if you want to use your 3 minutes, and use it completely, that's fine. I just want to encourage you to respect the time for everybody so we can get through and hear from everyone. Now then, our first speaker is going to be Father Jerry Creedon. And the reason I'm going to ask Father Jerry to come forward is because, as I told him, I don't want to stand between him and you for this afternoon. Father.
Or still between me and the penitents who are waiting for me. Don't deduct these seconds from my presentation. Jerry Creedon on the Pastor Bully family in Dale City. I'm also on the board of Virginia Catholic Conference on the Oversight Committee. I work with SALT and also chair of the Peace and Justice Commission of the Archdiocese. I'd like to on behalf of the Virginia Catholic Conference, support life issues, including curbing the use of the death penalty and opposing any expansion of the use of the death penalty. Support the agenda of Virginia Catholic Conference and SALT, and I won't repeat what will be presented to you by Kevin Raymond, but the issues he presents I support. They're the legislative priorities of SALT, which are included on the Virginia Catholic Conference. I'd like to focus more on one particular issue that affects me very directly, and that's the issue of driver's licenses for immigrants. And there will be some proposals presented. The DMV, that's a study group, they've come up with some options. They believe, as I believe, that we have been too restrictive in Virginia on the provision of driver's licenses for immigrants. Reaction to 9/11 and other things. It's important, I believe, to extend the availability of driver's licenses to immigrants. It's a safety question. It's a loss of resources to the state. And also because families need to get to work. Families need to have their people come to the hospital in time with serious illness. Driver's licenses are so essential. And it seems to me there are going to be a couple of presentations. I know Scott Surovell has an initiative, but there are others. At least the federal standards for residency need to be observed in the provision. That very standard itself would provide 6,000 more driver's licenses here in Virginia. So I support the provision of driver's licenses in a less restrictive way especially to people with legal residence, but to immigrants. Just last week, I met a couple that asked for their identification. They gave me driver's licenses from Maryland, even though I knew they lived in Dale City. That shouldn't be the case. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you so much. Okay, we will now hear from Mercedes Kirkland Doyle, followed by Karen Smith. So the first person wants to come up, and then the second person can sort of queue up. Mrs. Kirkland Doyle, followed by Mrs. Smith.
Your mic isn't on.
Right. Sorry about that. We will be followed now by Mercedes Kirkland Doyle, who will be followed by Karen Smith. Either one of those two folks here? Karen? Okay. Karen will...
Good afternoon, and thanks so much for having us here today to speak. You heard some of my presentation last week if you were attending the state budget hearing, but my own senator has not heard that, but I think he knows where I'm standing on that. I'm Karen Smith, with the executive director of the ARC, the Greater Prince William, and we, again, still have 11,000 people waiting for a Medicaid waiver. And some of those families are very desperate. We support several thousands of them through the ARC services, either residential, day services, or even in our education programs. And these folks are needing your help and support, and we ask that you reject the governor's proposal to cut some of those waiver services. We need more, not less. And just today, as I walk down here, I met two families I had not met before who have children either on the wait list or just literally got off the wait list. I didn't know them. Here in our community of Prince William County, we have several hundred people that are in dire straits for a waiver. And when you talk about the fact that you're talking about giving support to an individual with intellectual and developmental disability, you're also giving support to that family. And you talk about mental health issues. You have a child with a severe disability in that family, there usually are mental health issues by other family members just trying to survive and take care of that individual. The other thing I would like to point out is the fact that we have gone through Medicaid reform, and as far as our agency is concerned, the jury's still out about reform. All we know is we have $170,000 in our residential program that have not been paid, and this year we think we will be getting $150,000 less for our day program. Now you need to know that the ARC of Greater Prince William across the state is known for supporting those with the most complex medical needs. And because of that, want me to stop?
No, you'll
have to be here. Okay, and because of that, this has gotten to be a concern about how folks are going to receive services. Our agenda statewide is quite complete. You'll be hearing more about that in the future, and so I don't want to take up your time, but please support individuals who have developmental disabilities. All of you have done a great job before, and we hope that you'll continue to do that. Thanks.
Thank you, Karen. Do you have any other issue from the Secretary? Okay, am I zeal to make sure that everybody, that we started off getting to hear from you, I forgot that we should introduce ourselves. And now Senator McPike is here, so we'll begin with him.
All about time. Jeremy McPike, served for the 29th Senate District, which is Manassas Park down to Dale City and the western part of Woodbridge. Apologize being a few minutes late, I had to attend a personal family funeral this afternoon that was occurred after we scheduled it, so appreciate hearing from everyone today.
I'm Scott Surovell, I represent the 36th Senate District, and James Madison University is about to win the national championship in about 15 minutes, I think. And I represent the Occoquan, Woodbridge, Dumfries Triangle, and Montclair parts of Prince William County.
I am George Parker in the State Senate. You are in the 39th Senate District. Welcome to the 39th District. If you live here at the McCourt Building, Delegate Anderson and I would be your representatives in Richmond. So certainly I enjoy representing Prince William County. I cover the part of Prince William County between the line for the town of Occoquan and the city of Manassas on sort of the north side of the Prince William Parkway.
I'm Marshal. I was first elected in 1991. I represented this area and down into Occoquan for 10 years. Then I was moved over to the center of the county and went all the way across Route 7 into Loudoun. Then I was moved back again. It's not that I'm not paying my bills, I just keep getting around here. And I represent kind of central Prince William, parts of Gainesville, Manassas, Manassas Park, and Haymarket. And I butt up against the district of the delegate.
Good afternoon, Delegate Rich Anderson. I represent the 51st House District, which runs from the west end of Occoquan Town up through Lake Ridge, West Ridge, the county portions of Manassas, and out to Oaksville.
Good afternoon, Delegate John Bell, and I represent the 87th District in the House of Delegates, which is Loudoun and Prince William County's parts of each. Starts in Sterling, goes up through the South Riding Area, 66, all the way out, and three Prince William precincts in Haymarket. So thank you for braving the weather and getting out here, and glad to see so many people here today.
And I'm Scott Lingamfelter. I represent the 31st District, which is Montclair, Southerndale City, into the Coles District along 234, and then leaps across back into Fauquier County. I think I'm the only guy up here who has dairy farms in his district. But in any case, and I am a proud, proud grandfather of two young kids. I'm very happy to have them on board. How many of you are grandparents? Isn't it much better? I also am on the Appropriations Committee. So for those of you who have money needs, as Karen had mentioned earlier, she's asking us to look seriously at the government budget. We will do that. Senator Barker sits on the Senate Finance Committee, so he and I work closely to make sure that all our members, both senators and delegates, have a pathway into the money process to make sure that we're taking care of the interest of our community. With that, let us continue. We will next hear from Chris Caseman, followed by Richard Jesse. Is Mr. Caseman? Is Mr.
No.
He's not here. Is Richard Jesse here? Okay. Anthony Kiesler? Yes, sir. And you will be followed by Barbara Latimer?
Sir.
Yeah, Barbara.
Yes, sir. Thank you for having us here today.
Glad you're here.
Tony Geisler, I am currently the president of the board of the Arthur Crater Prince William, worked with Karen. I've been on the board for about a dozen years. And I want to reiterate what she said, but one thing we realize as the board is we have employees that come and work there because they love the work they're doing. It's not because they get paid a lot. In fact, we even have some that come in, get our training, because as Karen says, we're considered the role model agency, and then leave for better jobs. But the other thing I want to talk about is how it affects me personally. I first got involved with the arts because I had a daughter at age 15 once had surgery and had a massive stroke, developmental disabilities. Through elementary school, 6th, 7th grade, she was in the school system kind of catching up. But then she started having seizures, and because of the seizures, she was spending more time in either the ambulance or the hospital than she was in school. And so we took her out of school, and we were lucky enough that we got a waiver. And she had an aide, she was able to get the therapy she needed. And just to reiterate the importance of that, with that 11,000 on the waiting list, it's something that I personally believe and I personally know of, and just would like your support for it.
Thank you very much, sir. I appreciate it. Barbara Larimer will be followed by my good friend Kevin Raymond.
Good evening.
Hi, everyone. My name is Barbara Larimore. I'm Delegate Anderson. He knows me. He knows what I'm here to talk about, and that is more recess and PE in elementary school, a cause that is really near and dear to my heart. I brought my three small kids with me today so you can see how much physical education and being active is necessary. I started this when my first son was in kindergarten, and I noticed that, you know, he would develop these nervous habits of chewing on his shirts and chewing on these shirts up here to where they would get holes in them. And I thought, what is this? Why is this all of a sudden developed as when he started kindergarten? And I just piecing things together and putting the pieces together, it just, when I look at the schedule of what we have now, 15 minutes for a five-year-old, which is what my kindergartner over there has, it's just not enough for a 6.5-hour day. So I've kind of started this. I'm having this pep rally, which is the paper that you guys have now. And it's a pep rally to support more recess and more PE. I know that it's possible because when I talk to other schools, top-rated schools in the state of Virginia, that this is what they're doing. This is what they're doing to make their kids functional, to make their kids happy, and to make their kids achieve. I would like Prince William County to follow these models and to give them more recess, more PE, more options in terms of how to make their day easier so the teachers can spend less time behavior managing and more time teaching, which is what their real job is to teach the children and to have the kids ready and their minds ready and focused. And they can do that by getting their wiggles out, by getting their recess, getting their social emotional needs out first, their basic needs met, and then they are able to focus and sit down in the classroom. So this is something that all your constituents agree with. Any mom or dad or teacher, principal, superintendent that I've talked to says, absolutely, yes, I agree with you. But the question is how to make it happen. And it really starts with the top and also from the bottom. And between the two of us, we can make anything happen. So please think about it. There are tons and tons and tons of studies that show that this is where we're going. It's not the SOL testing culture that we should be moving toward. It's what we should be moving away from and going toward what I'm sure some of you had when you guys were in school, more recess, more PE, more physical activity to let children be children and thereby be able to learn more. Thank you.
Thank you very much for presenting. We're gonna go to Kevin Raymond. I see Chairman Stewart is here and he's gonna have some remarks and then we'll go back to listening to citizens and tell us what is on their mind. Chairman Stewart.
Your mic's on.
I'm sorry. When I see Chairman Stewart is here, we've asked Kevin Raymond to speak, and then Chairman Stewart will speak, and then following Chairman Stewart, we'll have Mr. Bruce Smith from AARB. Kevin, thank you, sir.
Thank you. Good afternoon, distinguished members of the Virginia General Assembly. My name is Kevin Raymond. I represent Holy Family Church, Catholic Church Advocacy Group, and SALT. Please join me in a moment of silence in remembrance of Senator Colgan, who is a great champion of our causes. First, the Holy Family Advocacy Group asks that you consider passing a bill sponsored by Senator Surovell and Delegate Moisky that would grant driver's licenses to undocumented residents who pass the driver's test and are also insured. They need to drive to their jobs, take children to daycare, and shop for food. Is equally important. We have they will also be insured and know the driving rules. Also, we strongly endorse expansion of Medicaid. So provide medical assistance to thousands of poor Virginians and also help strengthen the financial condition of hospitals throughout the Commonwealth. According to the most recent census data, there are 30,150 residents living in poverty. We certainly owe something to bring them up to speed who, through no fault of their own, are in this position. Also, according to the Virginia Hospital Association, from 208 to 215, the overall rate of Virginia hospitals operating in the red range from 25% to 37%. In the rural areas, 42% to 63%. Please remember these disturbing trends in your legislative considerations. We don't want our hospitals to close because of this. Saw the six initiatives for your consideration. Incidentally, I passed out my talk here, but also I have the agenda for social services, which the chairman of the Social Services Advisory Board, Hildenbar, asked me to pass out, so that's for your information. The six initiatives of SALT, join 38 other states and eliminate the food stamp assets test of $5,000. The increases would be 100% federally funded and no immediate adverse impact on the Virginia budget. The current assets test harms low-income families with children, especially our military families. Eliminate the lifetime ban on food stamps for ex-drug felons who have fulfilled their debt to society. Stop punishing these families with children. This will also aid in smoothing of reentry efforts. Third, adjust to the child support for people in prison. Pursuant to executive order, this would help families support their children when a parent is incarcerated. Virginia is one of 14 states, only 14 states, that do not adjust while in prison. Keep in mind that the average salary for prisoners is 20 cents an hour. Oh, no. Okay. Thank you for listening. It's out here. Also, I would like to invite you to we're going to have a Vesper service on February 9th. And Father Creedon's going to be there, and our new bishop. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kevin, for coming. Mr. Smith, I'm going to ask Chairman Stewart to go ahead, and then you follow Chairman Stewart. Chairman Stewart, welcome, sir.
Well, thank you. Great to be here, and it's an unusual perspective. Usually up there listening to you, so. Anyway, I just want to thank you and each one of you for your service to the Commonwealth, and I want to thank all the citizens here from Prince William County as well for coming out here on this snowy day. We can talk about a lot of things, all of you have our agenda for the county, including education and everything else. We've got our priorities. The one thing I do want to talk about today and kind of highlight is the opioid crisis in the United States, including heroin. Last year, there were almost 13,000 overdoses from heroin, and it's growing. It's growing very fast, and it's affecting Prince William County. Last year, in the previous 12 months, rather, 487 cases of heroin overdoses in Prince William County alone. It's growing. We don't actually even know what the true extent of the problem is and how fast it's growing, but we do know that it is a potential epidemic that we've got to address. I know that Delegate Hugo has got some legislation that he's submitted to try to address the situation. Obviously, in the local level, we could use your help, 599 funding for police. If you could find a way to fully restore that, that would help us all greatly. Other than that, I just want to say thank you very much. Happy New Year. And whatever we can do to help here on the county side, we'd be happy to do so. And thank you for your service again.
Thank you, Chairman Stewart. Let me just say that I appreciate you bringing up the issue on heroin. This is going to be I'm quite certain we're going to spend a great deal of energy trying to address the problem. It is a very serious problem. And on top of that, we have an issue with, quite frankly, people who sell this stuff to people who overdose and die, and they're not adequately dealt with in the criminal justice system. And so we'll be looking at legislation in that area as well. I know Delegate Marshall has a study to look at the use of her in the Commonwealth, and that's important for us to get our arms around. I know Senator McPike and I have sat on the Secure Commonwealth panel, and we've looked at the Narcan, long-term drugs, and to ensure that our police and emergency responders have this in the event that they come across someone who is overdosed. There's some real policy issues with that, and we'll work through it, and we'll try to help you as best we can.
Good, great. By the way, we support your legislation on the concealed carry permit, so thanks a lot, everybody.
I'm very glad to see that that's been revealed.
If I could mention something on the opioid issue. I recently went public with my son's request. My son is suffering from opioid addiction. And he is actually in treatment right now. He gets out of treatment tomorrow. He's doing really, really well. But my family's experienced this since this past April. He is a veteran. He had a job for 10 years and a very responsible person. He had a car accident, hurt his neck, and I got on pain meds and got addicted and suffered the case that many people have suffered, and we've learned from it. So I will be introducing legislation that the administration's asked me to introduce this year. One of them is to restrict emergency room prescriptions to only 3 days, because people are shopping around and getting large prescriptions from emergency rooms. So I am willing to share my story and I'm nobody special, but I tell you, this is going to happen to any family. I've met 80-year-olds who've been addicted to opioids, and I've met parents of 12-year-olds who are addicted to opioids. This is a crisis. Thank you, Chairman Stewart, for mentioning that and for bringing it up. And this is not a political issue. Addiction doesn't care what party you're from. And we need to treat it as a crisis, and we need to work together. And I believe my colleagues will too, work together on this crisis. So thank you for bringing that up.
Thank you, Delegate Bell. We're going to be followed now by Mr. Smith from AARP. Thank you for your indulgence, sir. And Mr. Smith will be followed by Senator Dawson.
Thank you very much, Chairman Lingamfelter, other members of the General Assembly. Good afternoon. My name is Bruce Smith. I live in Woodbridge. Besides representing AARP, which I am today, I'm also a retired teacher for Prince William County Schools. I serve on the board of Prince William County Education Association and the VEA. AARP Virginia is fighting to put a secure retirement within reach for people who work hard and plan for their future. The expectation of a comfortable retirement is no longer a reality for far too many Virginians. Instead, thousands face the risk of running out of savings after they retire. Delegate Torian and Senator Ruff will introduce companion bills to increase access to payroll deduction individual retirement accounts. 73% of surveyed Virginia voters agree elected officials should set up a state-run retirement savings plan so all workers can have an opportunity to save through payroll deductions. Workers are 15 times more likely to participate in an IRA when it's offered at work. A state-run retirement savings plan will make it easier for employers to offer a plan for workers to grow the additional savings they will need to live a secure and independent future. This will save taxpayer dollars because fewer Virginia retirees will need to rely on government safety net services. Enrollment is voluntary for employers and employees. The state and employer are not responsible for an employee's gains or losses in the market. Please be on the lookout for these bills to increase access to retirement accounts through payroll deductions. AARP's other legislative priorities for 2017 include long-term service and supports. Many long-term care recipients are medically and emotionally too frail to speak up for themselves. The state long-term care ombudsman program, which acts as the voice of these individuals to resolve the problems, has never been fully funded to meet the minimum staffing ratio set by the General Assembly. That's one ombudsman to every 2,000 nursing home and assisted living beds. AARP Virginia advocates for $2.1 million to be appropriated to meet the state standard. This amount includes $289,721 to provide ombudsman response to recipients of home and community-based services. We are far behind in our commitment to these folks so far. Family caregivers. AARP Virginia supports an establishment of a committee to study the issues related to family caregivers and long-term supports and services and report their findings and recommendations to the General Assembly and Governor. The state and stakeholders must develop methods to encourage and support family caregivers to assist their aging relatives and develop ways to recruit and retain qualified in-home care workforce. The budget. AARP Virginia will continue to monitor budget proposals to be sure that decisions are fair to all generations and do not place an unnecessary hardship on vulnerable Virginians. Thank you very much for your support.
Thank you for your comments. Senator Dawson. And Sandra will be followed by Andrew Baylor from the NAACP.
Good afternoon.
Sandra Baylor from the NAACP will be next in line.
Good afternoon, and thank you all so much for coming out today. We certainly appreciate it. My name is Sandra Dawson, and I serve two roles in Prince William County. I'm chair of both the Housing Board for Prince William County, and also I'm chair of the Prince William Area Commission on Aging, which serves not only Prince William County, but also the independent cities of Manassas and Manassas Park. And so I'll be speaking for both of those groups today. The Prince William Housing Board is an administrative board that's responsible for overseeing the expenditure of funds for home and community-based services and development, and directing the management of programs administered by the Office of Housing and Community Development. They were responsible for developing policies for meeting community needs for affordable housing. We serve as the Public Housing Agency Board in accordance with the requirements of the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. And our top four legislative priorities for 2017 are the following. One is to increase funding for the Virginia Housing Trust Fund. As you know, this fund is used for loans to reduce the cost of home ownership and also for rental housing, as well as providing grants to reduce homelessness, which is becoming an increasing problem around the state. And in connection with this, we'd also like to see the establishment of a dedicated funding for this Virginia Housing Trust Fund, so it's not an issue that comes up every year, but has dedicated funding. Second, we would like to increase the funding for transportation needs for the elderly and the disabled in order to facilitate improved health care and access to needed services into the community. We would like these individuals to be able to continue to live in their communities, and so they need this transportation to get there. And also with this, we would like to see an establishment of dedicated funding for this local transportation, which is a major issue. Third, we would like to see an improvement in accessibility and visitability of all housing through either regulations, ordinances, or zoning, so that all citizens can have access to their own housing in a meaningful way, as well as being able to visit other houses and other facilities. And the fourth issue for the Housing Board is to revisit the issue of proffers as they apply to housing and human services, as these funds are greatly needed as many of the communities grow so rapidly. Switching now to the Commission on Aging. The Commission on Aging is a federally mandated advisory commission to the Prince William Area Agency on Aging. We advocate for the three local governments on issues that impact older Virginians, their families, and their caregivers. And our top three legislative priorities are, first, to expand Medicaid to include Medicaid waivers and to provide increased funding. I will give you copies of my remarks and some additional information for the Commission on Aging. Our other two is transportation and trying to mandate this visitability. So both groups have the same goals in that area. So I'm going to move back.
Thank you very much. Next, we will have Andrea Bailey from the NAACP. Andrea's here. Okay, and Alan Mushnick from the Virginia Bicycling Federation will be followed by Margaret Smith from Active Prince William. Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon. Thank you. I'm Alan Mushnick with the Virginia Bicycling Federation and Active Prince William. The latter organization was founded 1 year ago to advance bicycling, walking, and public transportation in the Prince William County area. For the past 8 years, the Virginia Bicycling Federation has sought to improve justice for bicyclists injured by negligent motorists. As a result, the General Assembly has modified Virginia's traffic laws to finally prohibit motorists from following or passing bicyclists too closely and from carelessly opening the driver's door of a parked vehicle into the path of approaching traffic. While we appreciate these long-needed changes, more must be done to hold careless and distracted motorists accountable for their negligence. Last year, Senator Surovell and Delegate Sullivan each introduced bills to charge a careless or distracted motorist with a Class 1 misdemeanor and to suspend their driver's license for 1 to 3 years if their negligence is the proximate cause of serious physical injury to a vulnerable road user. Although both bills died in committee last year, we are pleased that both legislators will file similar bills this year. Delegate Sullivan's bill is HB 1633. We ask the entire Prince William delegation to endorse both bills as co-patrons. Distracted driving due to handheld electronic devices has been a growing cause of traffic crashes, injuries, and deaths for well over a decade. We strongly support Senator Surovell's SB 860, which would generally prohibit the manual operation of a handheld personal communications device while driving a motor vehicle and would establish a reckless driving charge if a violation of this new prohibition is concurrent with an additional traffic offense or if the violation results in a crash. We ask the Prince William delegation to strongly support this bill as well. Senator Surovell has also pre-filed the bill to establish a reckless driving charge for motorists who pass or attempt to pass another vehicle by driving in a bicycle lane. We fully support that bill and would also support a reckless driving charge when a motorist passes another same-direction motorist who is stopped at a marked crosswalk for a pedestrian or bicycle traffic. In 2015 and 2016, bills were filed to not reduce highway maintenance payments to municipalities that have implemented road diets, whereby the space occupied by one or more conventional travel lanes is reallocated to create one or more bicycle lanes. Road diets are widely used, including in Northern Virginia, to effectively retrofit bike lanes while simultaneously improving a road's capacity and safety for motorists. They should not be discouraged with counterproductive disincentives. We expect Delegate Villan Weber to carry the road diet bill this year, and we ask that you endorse its co-patrons. Cities including Manassas and Manassas Park would benefit significantly from this legislation. Thank you for considering my request. I have my remarks in writing and have a productive session. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Margaret Smith, followed by Riley O'Casey.
Good evening, gentlemen. My name is Margaret Smith, and I'm a long-time resident of Prince William County, and a grandmother of five, and one more coming in April. So it's great. It's great. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to speak on behalf of those of us who really like to move out of the county without having to use our vehicles. That's pretty much been the focus of Active Prince William, is trying to see where people are moving and trying to figure out some of the problems that we have getting out of the county. We're a new group. There's not a whole lot of us right now, but we've been able to identify quite a few problems. I've lived here for 38 years. I've seen a lot of change. This is here on 234, when it's just two lanes. Now it's four with a bike path and very busy. As an avid cyclist, many years ago, it was a challenge, really, to get anywhere in the county safely. As roads have been built and rebuilt, bike lanes have been added. Some signage has been done, but not enough. Being able to connect the county and have people be able to move about by public transportation on foot and by bicycle has pretty much been the focus of our group. While we have made great strides in our county, we need to continue to move forward. Improving our trail and path system will encourage people to get out. And, you know, that's kind of the focus, is getting people out and out of the cars. Looking at some of the large intersections, such as Southern Manor and Route 234. There's an intersection at Drive and 234, Dale Boulevard and Minneville Road. Those are some really big and dangerous intersections. Making them safer using traffic calming practices, road diets, better signage, can make our community safer for those on foot and by bike. We've done some other looking at trying to encourage people to use bikes on trains. Taking care of our bus shelters is a big push. As a group, we've been looking at different ways to help people move about the county and through the county without the use of their cars. Small things such as maintaining bus shelters, repairing bike paths, and you see this being done out on the parkway, taking down garland rails that separate communities will help people move about. Prince William County is also on a major bike route through the county north to south and also east to west. And we're a day's bike ride from D.C., so there's a real big tourist possibility there, bringing people through the county that right now is very difficult and fairly dangerous to come through. Anyway, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Margaret. Riley O'Casey, followed by Ken Bode.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the opportunity to share my concerns about public education. I saw quite a few of you Tuesday night at the Legislative Forum. Thank you very much for attending. My name is Riley O'Casey. I'm president of the Prince William Education Association and a very proud middle school teacher. The average salary for Virginia educators is more than $7,000 below the national average, ranking us 30th in the nation. 30th is not competitive. 30th makes the best teachers think twice about coming to Virginia. Too many teachers must work second and third jobs to survive. This is unacceptable. When funding decreases at the state level, as it has over the last few years, the burden is then placed on the localities that sometimes cannot afford it. Virginia's standards of quality lay out the foundational level of a program of quality education for our students. The SOQs, greatly damaged during the Great Recession, must be reversed. The Virginia Board of Education recently revised the SOQs
to reflect the increasing needs of our students and our schools, and you have the authority to ensure that these positive changes are made. Last year, my civics students took their SOL test on May 5th. That left 6.5 weeks of a loss of instructional time. I was able to do the fun stuff during this time, but the fun stuff would have reinforced my curriculum. When will everyone realize that a multiple choice standardized test will never accurately measure the worth of our students and the work our educators do every day? One size will never fit all. Assessments must be developmentally appropriate, and student progress must be measured in multiple ways. Instead of forking over an average of $20 million to Pearson, can we use that to accurately and effectively measure student progress? Public school enrollment in Virginia, as well as in Prince William County, continues to grow. Educator salaries, SOQs, and SOL testing reform rely on adequate funding. In the next few months, hundreds of educators will descend upon you to advocate for our students and our colleagues. And we won't give up advocating for our students, because this is why we're here. Please listen to us. We are the education experts. Make public education a priority in Virginia. Thank you.
Mr. Bodie will be followed by Carol Hoffman. Okay, Mr. Bodie's not here. Carol Hoffman. And Carol will be followed by Bruce Doyle. Bruce.
Good afternoon, senators and delegates. Thank you all for being here. I'm Carol Nava. I'm president of the local League of Women Voters. And I have several topics to talk about today, and we have a long list. But I'd like to start with school discipline. There are too many students who have suspended progress in their education because of long out-of-school suspensions. There's a fifth grade age boy in Prince William County who, because of some disruptive behavior, has been suspended this year. Not for one day, not for a week, but the entire school year. So he's not getting an education. This is the type of suspension that can add children to the school to prison pipeline. And that's what's in the report that I've given you. Yes, thank you. So please support some changes that are proposed by Delegate Richard Bell to decrease the suspension length, eliminate suspensions for pre-K to fifth grade, and to allow suspensions only for certain offenses. And I've listed the bills there, and I'm sure you can look those up faster than I can. We certainly are encouraging transparency at the General Assembly. So shouldn't your constituents know how you vote? Many times votes in committees are not recorded. And Delegate Ben Klein has a bill to require recording of your ayes and nays on all bills in committees and subcommittees so that the voters can see your votes online. Transparency is good government and shows respect for your constituents. And also, shouldn't the bills you introduce, or any bill that's been introduced, be heard by your colleagues? Delegate Klein's bill asked that those bills be heard. Would be supportive of him to sign on as a co-patron. Redistricting reform, we know there are many, too many races for the 100 House seats that have had only one candidate, the incumbent. So this is the year to change the process of drawing district lines. Child safety, I'd like you to support requirements for locks on guns. Make sure guns are in safes and locked boxes to prevent the tragic, unintentional injuries and death of children by children because of unsecured firearms in the home, the backyard, the car, or a truck. We also, of course, support election administration reform to improve and expand on the online voter registration, to allow absentee voting without the need for an excuse, and even to establish some practical changes in third-party registration practices. There are others, but sharing those with you today, and I appreciate your support very much and being here. And thank you, Delegate Bell, for being your courage to come bring the story to your family.
happy to share. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol, very much. Bruce Doyle, followed by Janet Doyle.
Thank you. My name is Bruce Doyle, and I reside at 8136 Hillcrest Drive in Manassas. I am also very sorry for passing a Senator Cogan, to be fair, fine gentleman. I became totally disabled as a result of a mid-brain stroke in 2004. It left me with aphasia and double vision, which makes it possible for me to read a 3-minute speech within the time. I included a copy of my remarks as attachment one in the presentation that I just gave you. I would appreciate if you would incorporate the full copy of my remarks into your official record due to my disability. My wife, who is my sole caregiver and primary breadwinner, retired after 41 years in the federal civil service. Two civil service demands the highest ethics, and appearances of impropriety cannot be tolerated. Judges and supervisors forget they work for the people, not just the wealthy developers who contribute to their campaigns. We both believe that Judges Covington and Horan interfered with our cases in the Circuit Court and Supreme Court of Virginia. Our Supreme Court case was denied by a hearing by all the justices without reason on the day of the Trump services tapes surfaced. We believe the timing of the decision to be a punishment rained by Judge Covington against my wife for daring to pursue the claims for damages against the developer supported by him while he was a supervisor. In the interest of justice, we ask that you request that the Supreme Court reopen and send our case back to the county for hearing on merits due to the appearance of fraud upon the court in both cases. We understand the procedure in place is for the former removal of judges. Judges may be impeached by the House of Delegates and removed by 2/3 of the Senate. We ask that you begin this procedure of impeachment for the judges Covington and Horan. Thank you very much for your time, gentlemen. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Doyle. Mrs. Doyle? And Mrs. Doyle will be followed by Joan Woolery.
Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, I wish to express my sorrow on the passing of former Senator Charles Colgan this week, and on Senator McPike's personal tragedy. My name is Janet Doyle, and I reside at 8136 Hillcrest Drive, Manassas, Virginia, in the Falls District. I am an experienced chemist, retired after 41 years of faithful service to the federal government. The clean water issues in Virginia are worsening due to two major factors. First, there's a flaw in the algorithm of the geographic information system used for land planning, which to my knowledge has not been fixed either properly or permanently to this day. I expressed concern about this to the board and DEQ as early as 2007. I showed Representative of DEQ the article. She didn't read it. She just stated the topography of Florida is not the same as that of Virginia. The article I showed her explained the defect in the algorithm that ignores one cell sinks, i.e. small pieces of low-lying land in an area as noise. Usually it is wetland. In our case, it's her property. The second factor is uncontrolled infill development in agricultural areas, which rely on well water from an aquifer. For nearly 13 years, this has been our well water, which is showing you a filter. I purchased my 1-acre piece of farmland in 1993. The well water was pristine. The flow of water toward our property was south-southeast toward the river. Our property is located between a watershed boundary Lake Jackson Drive and a secondary stream channel, which kept our property dry and could be observed in aerials since 1937. These are homes a company responsible for the downturn in the economy and which illegally filled up unpermitted stream channel at Parkway West site behind us, cut through the stream channel and built houses on it, which degrades our water, floods our property, and continues to cause damage to our home, which we can't fix. We can't ethically sell our home to move away as we wanted to do a long time ago. We can't clean our belongings. And it was a shrewd way we can't clean our belongings because of the infiltration of the construction soil. It was a shrewd way for former supervisor, now Judge Covington, Chairman Stewart, and Supervisor Noe to take our property without arousing suspicion that it was being taken and watch our statute of limitations run down as we complained to the county and attempted to negotiate with the builder. It's happening to other unsuspecting residents. My husband explained that our Supreme Court case 151573 Doyle v. Beezer Homes should be reopened by this panel and request the Supreme Court to remand it back to the Circuit Court for a full hearing on the merits in the interest of justice. The time of the recession when Beezer was not diligently pursuing construction was charged against our statute of limitations. Our case is a definite case of first impression for the court. It was more than just an appearance of fraud upon the court of our case. Covington never wanted it to see the light of day, and that's why I believe that it was terminated, especially on the day that the Trump tapes came out. It was a direct slap in my face forever challenging him based on the science and the watershed. And the science and the watershed, gentlemen, should dictate that how these developments are being built, not legislature and not the judiciary in total. It should be based on the good science in the watershed. I will be before the board and the planning commission as long as I can, as long as I have breath left. But my husband is disabled. He became disabled as a result of this development. We deserve a fair hearing.
Thank you, Mrs. Doyle.
Thank you so much.
Mrs. Joan Woolery. I'm sorry. John Loring will be followed by Pam Illar. I apologize if I mispronounce. Do we have Ms. Loring here? Okay, Ms. Pam Illar, right here. Nate Frizen will be followed by Gene Westcott, right here. Anna Marie Johnson.
I'm to you.
Thank you. Will be followed by Rachel Kirkland. And Mrs. Johnson, you're here to speak to us about the animal shelter.
Ms. Westcott,
I apologize.
That's okay.
Religious liberty for all, yes, okay.
Yes, hi, thank you very much for this opportunity, and thank you for your public service. As a Prince William County resident of many years, I believe that we're a community that really drives the values of Virginia and is, and we would like to have you represent us in Richmond and represent all Virginians. As you know, many religious groups appeal to the Virginia House of Delegates and the Senate to protect their own view of religious protection. But I would like to remind the legislators that Virginia has a long history of protecting against the establishment of any religion and protects all Virginians' freedom of religion. The Virginia Statute for Religious Freedom, drafted by Thomas Jefferson in 1777, is part of our Commonwealth heritage and was the model for the U.S. Constitution's First Amendment. Be it enacted by General Assembly that no man shall be compelled to frequent or support any religious worship, place, or ministry whatsoever, nor shall be enforced, restrained, molested, or burdened in his body or goods, nor shall otherwise suffer on account of his religious opinions or belief, but that all men should be free to profess and by argument to maintain their opinions in matters of religion, and the same shall in no wise diminish, enlarge, or affect their civil capacities. In practice, I would like to ask that we keep in mind, keep this in mind and protect Virginians from any religious-driven restrictions on their reproductive freedoms, oppose any restrictions on freedom to marry, restrictions against same-sex adoptions, and oppose any restrictions on access to literature in our schools and in our libraries. I've seen some of the policy agendas of some of the of religious groups and religious-driven groups, and I understand their desires for these restrictions and where it comes from, their own personal or religious-driven morality, but at the same time, we need to follow in the steps of our, the framers of the Virginia Constitution and U.S. Constitution and protect from the establishment of religion. Also, that I would ask that we protect the rights of religious minorities and vigorously oppose any attempts, I know we haven't discussed it on a local or state level, of registration based on religious affiliations, but if any kind of any kind of ideas that would hamper the practice of particular religions in this Commonwealth, I would hope that you reflect the values of Prince William County that esteem strength through diversity. And thank you very much, and have a great session, and hopefully we can all make some positive movements to make the Commonwealth of Virginia be the standard bearer that it always has been. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Westcott. Anna Marie Johnson. And Mrs. Johnson will be followed by Rachel Kirkland. Yes, ma'am.
Great, thank you. First, I have no fancy speech or anything prepared. I just want to first thank you guys so much for approving the new shelter, for Prince William Shelter. It's desperately needed. I did want to touch base.
I think the Board of County Supervisors deserves credit for that.
Thank you.
But, you know, we're politicians. If you want to give us credit for it.
Hey,
okay with that?
We'll take it.
It's kind of like scoring a touchdown that you didn't score. But go ahead.
Prince William, as a past volunteer with Prince William County Shelter, our county right now is 70 to 80% pit bulls in our shelter at all times. As a bully lover and an advocate, that's extremely high. So my concern for this county is one, building a relationship with rescues. Currently, as a 501c3 rescue myself, in order to foster in Prince William County, I can only hold a foster for 30 days because at that point in time, I am required by law to register that foster as my personal dog. So I'm asking for, you know, everyone to think about, you know, when we're looking at animal advocacy, rescues can't do anything if we are fighting against these laws. Also, I really feel that in Prince William Shelter, we need much more staffing. We're looking at a great new shelter, but until we get our staff up to that level of that new shelter and provide them with, you know, education to ensure they don't get burnout, to ensure they continue with their compassion, that's going to be a big thing for a new shelter. Also, we need much more education, spay and neutering, microchipping, shots in our county. With 70 to 80% pit bulls, there is no spay and neutering program in this area. We need to help our community and educate our community about all animals, but especially this breed. Also, you may have seen me on Channel 9 News with Mickey Burdine not long ago. I also worked with a homeless tent city here in Prince William County. I handle all their animals, and I was interviewed at that point in time. We have no weather laws here. If you look at other counties, for example, Maryland, if the temperature gets to a certain amount, they will do a code red, code blue, where all the animals must be taken in. We don't have that here in this county. We have so many homeless that are living in tents in the woods, and they have animals who have no resources. And I hate to tell you, in the last 2 weeks, there's more pit bulls in the woods right now. They've brought in more. So I'm literally fighting a losing battle and trying to help the community with working at the shelter. We need more support. We need, I need help chaining laws, weathering laws. Also, going on to my homeless, were you aware that three of my homeless people living in the woods were able to go to Prince William Shelter and adopt an animal? There's no background checks. There's no checks whatsoever. So I'm asking for assistance and help with this from this community to help me. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Rachel Kirkland, followed by Mr. Kirkland. Is Jacob here?
Jacob is here, Marshal rank, and asked that he speak to Mr. McPike, Senator McPike privately, and you are more than welcome to join in that conversation, but just the nature of what he's talking
about.
I'd be more comfortable.
Please continue.
I am Rachel Kirkland. I live in Manassas Park. mother of two boys, obviously, one of whom was here earlier. He is autistic. We just recently got off the DD, or the, yeah, development delay wait list after days before our ninth anniversary of being on that list. There are many people who are on the ID wait list who have waited longer. And I am asking that you look at the governor's budget because it doesn't do enough. You have a settlement with Jeff Gibney that was put into place by Bob McDonnell, and it's not really being honored the way it should be. You're going to continue to have problems with the U.S. Department of Justice if you cannot provide these services in the community. You're in the process, the state is in the process of closing down the training centers and selling the land. That money needs to be repurposed to clearing those wait lists, not going into general funds. You have thousands and thousands and thousands of people who are waiting for help. You have parents who worry that they're going to die before they see their child get the help that they need to sustain in their community. They're worried about whether or not their younger children will have to step in and take care of them if they're burdened their entire family by having a child with special needs. And I know many of you are pro-life legislators, and I know you get pulled a lot of different directions, but if you are for life, for all life, you need to put your money where your mouth is and to help people, because there's nothing for families like ours. And I waited a very long time to get the help that I got. And then I have to worry about going away with the supportive intervention instrument that they're using now. I mean, it's just always tenuous. You will always hear from us, and I don't think we're ever going to go away, and I'm really sorry about that, but not sorry. Thank you to the education person. I am also a teacher in Manassas City. I'm a school librarian. I'm also on the school board in Manassas Park. So I'd like to thank me for speaking in to Mr. Bell, Senator Bell. As the aunt of a girl who went to rehab three times for heroin, and the daughter of a man who has been addicted his whole life, I appreciate your struggle, and your legislation has my support because it will change lives. Thank you.
Well, thank you for being here today. And now we will go to Brenda Conway, followed by Rosalie Horton. Ms. Conway's not here. Ms. Horton. Okay. Shelley Jabondowski, followed by Dora Mahama. Ms. Pam, welcome.
Good afternoon. I am Shelley Jabondowski with I'm the Prince William County Coordinator and District 51 Captain for the Convention of States Project. I'm a constituent of Delegate Anderson and Senator McPike. First of all, I would like to thank Senators McPike and Barker for meeting with my colleagues, and Delegates Lingamfelter and Anderson for their tireless sponsorship and support. Further thanks to other delegates who have responded to emails and calls from our supporters. Patrick Henry said, "The Constitution is not an instrument for the government to restrain the people. It is an instrument for the people to restrain the government, lest it come to dominate our lives and interests." In that vein, the framers enabled the states and the people to reform Congress through Article 5 of the Constitution, where the states can both propose and ratify constitutional amendments without interference from Congress or the President. In 2013, the Citizens for Self-Governance launched the Convention of States Project. We are a grassroots, nonprofit, nonpartisan organization urging state legislators to properly implement Article 5 to call a convention under the topic of reducing Washington's power. Our plan does not focus on specific amendments. Those will be proposed by the states when they convene. However, any proposed amendments must be germane to imposing fiscal restraints on the federal government, limiting the power and jurisdiction of the federal government, or setting term limits for federal officials and members of Congress. For too long, the federal judiciary has supported Congress and the White House in their escalating attack upon the jurisdiction of the 50 states. political elites remain exempt from rules we must live by. Exorbitant spending and debt threatens bankruptcy for our children and grandchildren, and executive overreach has become routine. These constitutional affronts are exactly why the Convention of States was built into Article 5. Last year, the House of Delegates passed H.J. 3, which expired in the Senate Rules Committee. The new legislation, H.J. 547, and Senate Companion Resolution, expected to be filed soon, incorporates the requested text changes that further prevent a runaway convention. Later, my colleague, Lori Hackett, will offer some of the possible amendments and show that a convention of states is well documented and remains the singular answer. Washington, D.C. will never reform itself. Only you, our state legislators, have the constitutional authority to act as guardians of the people by rebalancing the power away from Washington's bubble-residing, self-interested obstructionists who will only continue to usurp power beyond their constitutional limits. Thank you for this opportunity to speak.
Thank you very much. Ms. Muhammad, followed by Mark Schrieffer. Is Mark here? Thank you. Hey, Mark, come on down. And Shura Muhammad? Is Shura Muhammad here?
I'm here.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm sure. Good afternoon.
I'm 65 and half blind.
Good afternoon, honorable delegates and senators. As the founder of the AWARE Project, an acronym for Advocacy for Women's Activism, Rights, and Empowerment, I stand on behalf of the most vulnerable and marginalized among us. Detailed in the brief I provided, I am urging four legislative actions that would support those living with mental illness and those suffering domestic violence. This brief is submitted in remembrance of the lives of three women in Northern Virginia. Natasha McKinnon, who was diagnosed with schizophrenia at the age of 12, and who tragically died from, quote, excited delirium, after being stun-gunned while in custody at a Fairfax County jail in 2015. And Crystal Hamilton, who lived less than 5 minutes from here in one of the wealthiest neighborhood enclaves in Woodbridge, trapped in silence in an abusive marriage, and tragically died in her home after her husband shot both her and Officer Ashley Gittard, a rookie who responded to her domestic violence call in 2016. The first two actions are related to the redundancy of HB 1480 and calling for the creation of a mental health awareness training that would be required of all first responders. This training already exists in the National Crisis Intervention Team Program curriculum, which was supported by the General Assembly in legislation passed in 2009. I urge you to redirect legislative focus on strengthening the current CIT program in Virginia by making it a required standard in all localities and expanding funding to increase the number of fully operational programs. There are only 26 fully operational CIT programs serving an estimated 85 of the 133 localities in the Commonwealth. The remaining two actions are related to the budget exclusion of housing supports that were recommended by the Deeds Commission to study the mental health service system. In order to achieve a balanced improvement to the system, we must commit equal investment at the front end of entry and access, as well as the back end of emergence and independence, the delivery point where housing becomes essential, whether it is permanent supportive housing, transitional housing, or affordable housing. It is a grave misstep not to incorporate into the 2017 Commonwealth budget new funding for critical housing supports needed in reforming the system, because we have already seen admittances into psychiatric hospitals double within the past 2 years of the first pieces of legislation passed upon the recommendations of the Deeds Commission, which focused on improving entry and access in a crisis. While the prison system has become a de facto institution housing the mentally ill, more than 10% of patients who are ready for discharge from institutionalized care remain in psychiatric hospitals because they do not have anywhere to live. While I will be working on draft legislation for 2018 that will focus on removing barriers to expanding the supply of affordable housing, I have submitted to you all a draft resolution to establish a policy imperative of expanding affordable and transitional housing options that would include those living with mental illness and domestic violence survivors in the housing priority classifications of those vulnerable to homelessness. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes, sir, please step forward. And Mr. Schrieffer will be followed by Jennifer Bukowski.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the opportunity to provide public comment. My name is Mark Scheifler. I'm a principal and county resident. Please consider the following three transportation items during this year's session. Number one, the Commonwealth Transportation, Commonwealth of Virginia was recently awarded a federal fast line grant for the Atlantic Gateway Project. The Atlantic Gateway Project leverages public and private investments to improve the I-95 corridor between Richmond and Washington, D.C. These include rail and road improvements such as express line extensions, widening your SL Road, and a new crossing on the Rappahannock River, and additional rail on the CSX mainline. Unfortunately, these improvements will further exacerbate the largest choke point in Northern Virginia around the I-95, VA-123, and US Route 1 interchange, according to the MCOG congestion dashboard. This location on I-95 South was delayed for 21 days out of the whole, in the last quarter. So that's one-third of the time that there's a delay at that location. And it was largest in Northern Virginia. This has a direct impact on the quality of life of Prince William County citizens. This location is also a major safety deficiency. It's very dangerous to have four-lane chopper 3 on a downhill slope of the river with traffic merging onto I-95 South from US Route 1 while traffic merges off of I-95 South 2, VA-123, and 1,200-foot merge area on the bridge crossing. This is a major freight issue, and large trucks cannot use the express lane, also in Nevada on weekends when the express lanes are in the opposite direction. Please consider adding preliminary engineering and design funding as part of the budget to determine a preferred alternative for improvements along north and southbound 95 between US Route 1 and the Prince William Parkway. This project cannot be evaluated by smart scale until a preferred alternative has been determined. The handout includes my recommendation for improved traffic flow in this area without adding any general purpose lanes. Adding general purpose lanes could result in an I-95 express lane compensation event. Number two, please consider passing Senate Bill 740T that was continued to the 2017 session by the Virginia House of Delegates. This bill places a floor on the price of gasoline as the regional gas tax is imposed on Northern Virginia that is identical to the floor used for the state gas tax and increases the regional gas tax from Northern Virginia 2.1% to 3%. This user fee will help support stable transit funding from Prince William County for PRTC, VRE and WMATA as the region continues to grow and the roads become more congested. WMATA needs an additional $39 million in operating funding for next fiscal year, and the money's going to have to come from somewhere, and this is a good option, and it also benefits PRTC and VRE. And thirdly, please consider drafting a bill allowing the Northern Virginia Transportation Authority to use regional transportation funding, the 70% distribution, to purchase rail car equipment for WMATA and VRE, even though they may not be stored within the Planning District 8. This would provide additional funding for VRE and WMATA. MBTA has $1.8 billion to spend on transit and highway projects in the next 6 years, and rail cars are a cost-effective way to increase transit capacity. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Jennifer Rukowski, and followed by Denise Andrews. Yes, ma'am. Pleasure here.
Hi, thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Jennifer Rukowski. I reside in Delegate Anderson and Senator Barker's districts. I would like to speak to you today about redistricting reform. Virginia is ranked as one of the most gerrymandered states in the country, both on the congressional and state levels, on lack of compactness and contiguity of its districts. In the Constitution of Virginia, Article 2, Section 6, it states, quote, every electoral district shall be composed of contiguous and compact territory and shall be so constituted as to give, as nearly as it's practical, representation in proportion to the population of the district, end quote. In Prince William County, there are 5 state senators and 8 representatives in the state general assembly, representing just a portion of Prince William County. Congressionally, I reside in Congressman Whitman's district. My best friend, who lives in York County, just outside of Williamsburg, also has Congressman Whitman as her representative. Based on the Constitution of Virginia, I think we can agree that our districts are not contiguous and compact. 7 out of 10 voters agree with redistricting reform. The next time the General Assembly redraws the lines will be in 2021. I urge you to help create or support a fair criteria bill. In the packet that I handed out, it discusses the options for the fair criteria bill. In 2016, Senators Vogel and Howe patroned Senate Bill 59 and Delegate Landis patroned House Bill 555, its companion bill. The Senate bill passed in the Senate, but both bills were left in the House of Delegates Subcommittee of Privileges and Elections, according to the Virginia Bill Tracker System. Once bills are introduced this session, I'll reach out to you with recommended bills from One Virginia 2021, a nonpartisan group for fair redistricting. Virginia deserves to have fair representation in the Virginia General Assembly and the U.S. House of Representatives. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, Ms. Andrews, followed by Gregory Scott. Is Mr. Scott here?
I am.
Thank you, Mr. Scott. Would you please step forward, followed by Lori
Hackett. Good afternoon. My name is Greg Scott. I'm a founder of a grassroots advocacy group called the 66 Alliance. I will admit to you that I am a foreigner. In other words, I am from Fauquier County. However, I have several...
Welcome home.
I'm moving in, perhaps because of what's going on with 66. But Valerie Brown, Brian and Lisa Smith, and John Boscow, all of whom are Prince William residents, are here to support what I have to say. As I said, we are a grassroots organization. I think several of you are familiar with the work we have done. We are united, it basically started in my kitchen about 2.5 years ago. We were united by three goals. One was to preserve the carpool rule of two people in a car on 66. The second was to preserve the clean fuel vehicle exemption on 66 and the HOV lanes. And the third was prohibiting tolling of reverse commuters on I-66. We've grown from three individuals to over 1,500 at this point, including 400 here in Prince William County. And in 2016, we achieved two of our three goals in victories, either in the General Assembly or through administrative action with VDOT. That would be the HOV2 preservation and the no tolling reverse commuters. What's still on the table right now in 2017 is seeking a victory on the third issue, which is preserving the clean fuel vehicle exemption on 66 inside the Beltway. Without action by the General Assembly in the second quarter of 2017, when the tolling gantries go live, I will no longer be able to drive my gasoline electric hybrid, which Virginia promised me about 15 years ago, if I bought, I could continue to do, from the Beltway into the Roosevelt. Signed letters, or several of you have signed letters to the governor supporting an extension of the CFP program inside the Beltway and a study of looking to renew it with next generation vehicles such as all electrics or hydrogen powered vehicles. This is a nonpartisan issue. We've sent letters to the governor with an equal number of signatories on both sides. At this point, Delegate Tag Greeson from Loudoun is going to lead legislation in the House. He's going to be seeking co-patrons for that legislation. We've got senators lining up to do a companion bill on the Senate side. Again, that will be bipartisan, and we'd like your support on that. We urge you to join your colleagues in supporting these bills on Lobby Day, which is a new thing I hadn't really heard about before. We're going to have about 100 Alliance members down in the General Assembly Administrative Building, beating on doors and trying to get people to sign up to get on board with that. So that will be our coming out party, if you will. This is not a contest between anybody but VDOT and the commuters. We'd like you to stand with the commuters.
I think Delegate Marshall has something on point very briefly.
Mr. Scott, I hear your tale of woe, but just wait until VDOT reduces from four free lanes right now to three, and they add tolled lanes, taking a highway that taxpayers have paid for, give it to a company from Spain, and they're going to be allowed to charge at least $92 a day round trip from Haymarket to Washington, D.C. I have been continuing to fight this, and I still think it benefits the public good, but I will still continue to do what I can for your efforts on the gasoline free cars.
I looked up at the tolling sign on 66 the other day, Mr. Marshall, and it was $26 to get from 66 over to 395. You have my support as well.
And VDOT has yet to give me the rationale. They will not give me the data for their claim on as to how it will reduce traffic. So this apparently is a state secret that I, you know, nobody can get, so thank you.
Maybe the Russians can get it.
The Russians.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your time. By the way, Lobby Day, for all of you, just keep this in mind. If your organizations have Lobby Day, please come and visit us. We want to see you. We want to visit with you. I will tell you, I can speak for all of us, if you see a blur, it's us running through the hallway. I mean, that's how fast-paced it is when we're there. But when we have constituents that come and visit, we really enjoy spending time with you. So, you know, just gut it out, come to our office. You know, if you got to walk with me over to the Capitol or walk with colleagues over to the Capitol, they're happy to have you come over and spend time with them there too, or get us off the floor when we're in committee. We represent you. That's our job. Thank you, sir.
I always tell them to say yes for an answer, though, Mr. Lingamfelter.
Yes.
So if you say yes, walk away.
That's right. That's a good point. Okay. Thank you, sir. Lori Hackett. And Mrs. Hackett will be followed by David Kennedy. David, you here? And if David is not here, then Pam, you will be followed by Brent Fries.
Yes,
sir.
Yes, ma'am.
My name is Laurie Hackett, a volunteer with the Convention of States Project. Since my colleague Shelley Jablonowski has stated the context of the Convention of States Project, I'd like to share its history. The historical record proves that conventions were common in the days of our founding fathers, but the first one being held in 1689. 30 more followed into the 18th century. In fact, 11 of those were held between 1776 and 1787. The founders fully understood the rules, process, and benefits of conventions. The citizens fully understood conventions as well. Since then, 4 more conventions have been held, 3 in the 19th century and the last one in 1922. Some of the later movements to call a convention of states are commonly attacked as having fallen apart, but in fact, they did their job. Why? We, the people, demanded action at different points in history that by calling the Convention of States, they pressured Congress to enact amendments that they previously ignored. Last September, the Convention of States Project held a very successful simulation in Williamsburg, Virginia, to show modern-day citizens how a Convention of States would work. Over 2 days, legislators from 50 states convened as commissioners to propose amendments under the particular subjects that make our project unique: fiscal restraint, federal overreach, and term limits. So what were the amendments proposed in the practice simulation? The public debt shall not be increased except upon a recorded vote of 2/3 of each House of Congress. Number 2, term limits on Congress. Number 3, limiting federal overreach by returning the Commerce Clause to its original meaning. Number 4, limiting the power of federal regulations by giving an easy congressional override. Number 5, require a supermajority for federal taxes and repeal of the 16th Amendment. Number 6, give the states by a 3/5 vote the power to abrogate any federal law, regulation, or executive order. Before the simulation, we, the people, submitted their ideas for amendment proposals, which the commissioners heard and acted upon. I watched that simulation. The commissioners were attentive, not only to closely following the rules of the convention, but also the Constitution itself, as they strove for accuracy and clarity. The citizens of over 30 states are currently petitioning their legislators to call for a convention of states. Because 8 states have listened to the people, they have called a convention of states. Will Virginia be number 9? Thank you for listening to how you too can be a part of history by helping we, the people of Prince William County, move the power of the federal government back to the states where it belongs. Later, my colleague Remy Simon will counter misconceptions about a convention of states.
Thank you, Ms. Hackett. David Kennedy, I just want to call one more time. Brent Fries, followed by Kathy Strittmaster. Is Kathy here?
Hey.
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
My name is Brent Fries, and I first and foremost want to thank you for allowing me the opportunity to speak. Today I stand before you because my daughter Peyton Rose Freeze cannot. On the morning of February 10th, 2016, Peyton took her own life. I'm sorry.
Thank you for your time.
She was 17 and had less than 4 months from graduating from high school. She revealed to me the night before that she was being severely bullied at school, and that she felt alone trying to cope with what her peers were saying about her and to her. She felt like she had nowhere to turn. I told her that night that I had walked with her through this, and that I was going to go with her to school in the morning and try to see what I could do to be there for her. Unfortunately, I never got that chance. After our tragic loss, my family started Peyton's Project. We are a 501c3 nonprofit organization that is focusing on anti-bullying and cyberbullying, as well as a few other causes. Under the umbrella of Peyton's Project is Freeze Bullying for Peyton, which has a Facebook following over 5,200 people spread across 9 different countries. Bullying is a significant social problem that unfortunately affects too many of our children on a daily basis, at school and at home. I invite you to just visit our page to see for yourself. Not only are there unfortunate accounts of bullying and cyberbullying, but there are uplifting stories and a social network of people who want to help others. The legislation that I'm asking you to consider are some modifications and additions to existing anti-bullying and anti-cyberbullying laws that the Commonwealth currently has on the books, namely House Bills 744, 1187, 1624, 1871, and Senate Bill 951, as outlined in the document that I provided. The document outlines a broad spectrum of changes, from plugging the gaps in the current laws to better protect our youth from bullying behavior, identifying ways to assist in the remediation of the bully or the bullies, recommending some training that will benefit the school systems and not only bullying behavior and prevention, but mental health as well. And the recommendation on ways to leverage other Commonwealth of Virginia entities that may better be suited to assist the youth in those instances that they do experience bullying. These changes have the ability to catapult the Commonwealth of Virginia into the forefront of the most comprehensive anti-bullying and anti-cyberbullying laws in the nation. I am here to ask for your assistance to allow myself, my family, and my community to be able to put some legislation in place so that we can hopefully prevent another father, another mother,
take your time, sir,
or a loved one to have to face this world without one of our most precious gifts, our children. Thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Let me just say on behalf of all of us, you have our deep respect for the courage and the faithfulness that you kept with your daughter.
Thank you.
I know she's looking down and she's very proud of you.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, my name is Kathy Scriptmatter. Thank you for the opportunity to speak from the heart on a very important topic to me and to Peyton's Project. Bullying and mental health issues and suicide are on the rise locally, nationally, and internationally. Read any study by renowned and respected organizations such as the CDC, watch the news, read newspaper articles, and even live stream on social media. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to know that we are on the brink of mental health issues at epic proportions in our world. How we treat one another is affecting our kids.
What is published in our media, and in particular social media, is having a profound effect on society and especially our children. In 2014, children who were the ages of 14 to 17 years old had a 34.5% increase in suicides in the state of Virginia as compared to 2013. So in a year, we had a 34.5% increase. These are the last statistics available to us. This is from the Virginia Department of Health. If we want to understand the rise in bullying and suicide rates in our state, we have no further to look at than ourselves in the adult world and how we behave politically, corporately, professionally, and personally towards our colleagues, our friends, our neighbors, and our family. We have an opportunity as adults to get serious, very serious about this topic of how we treat one another and how this behavior is affecting mental health in our society and particularly our youth. According to the CDC, children who are bullied or those bullied or those being bullied, they're at a much greater risk of suicidal thoughts. Time is of the essence that we enact Putin's law that helps stop bullying now. Time is of the essence that we offer the proper resources to our schools, our healthcare professionals, and parents to have what they need to assist our children who are struggling and for all of us, for ourselves. Anyone from sports figures and celebrities, healthcare providers, attorneys, teachers, police, judicial system, to the everyday common man intuitively knows we're on a precipice of human behavior in our world. And it's time to get serious to do what's right. And it starts with all of us, here, now. I implore you to take steps to help bring the best in our humanity by allocating appropriate funds to strong mental health for your constituents, but to also enact Peyton's Law so there is clear understanding of consequences of bullying behavior and to provide programs for healing for victims as well as the perpetrators. Nothing is more important in life than how we treat one another. The golden rule is at the essence of our humanity, and you have the opportunity to enact Peyton's Law and to appropriate proper funds accordingly to support this golden rule. Please start today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And your testimony and the insights of the gentleman before were very helpful to us. In 2005, I drafted the bullying law that required parents to be notified if a child was bullied. And to facilitate communication on this, and unless forbidden by the federal government, that the parents should be brought in on this and to include bullying in character education. But your insights, again, would be very helpful in modifying this. This has been 11 years since we passed this. So I thank you for coming here, and we will definitely work with you to try to modify the current statute. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Delegate Marshall. Now we will go to, I think, is it Mrs. Walton who's next, or did Mrs. Walton just speak? Ms. Walton? And Mrs. Walton will be followed by Eric Marks of PRTC.
Good afternoon. My name is Dale Marie Walton, and I'm also an police bullying for Peyton County. Dream the impossible dream. A song from Mayor of La Mancha that some of us know. My dream is that we have strong mental health programs and counselors in our public schools. Shockingly, according to the prevalence of mental health disorders, one in four students in the United States are presently experiencing a form of mental illness. So what can be done to improve the mental health in our schools? First, there needs to be a law that states that all educators or anyone working with children in the schools take a minimum 3-hour class on mental health awareness. The National Council for Behavioral Health publishes an excellent manual on ways to help youngsters who are experiencing a mental health crisis. The class will assist all school personnel to become knowledgeable about resources and methods to employ when a student is experiencing a mental health issue. This includes cafeteria workers, as well as bus drivers, everybody who works with kids. With this training, we can reduce our youth suicide rates, and we can help these kids gain coping skills. On side note, we have physical education in schools. Why not have mental health education classes as well? Don't our bodies and our minds work together? Next, I submit a recommendation that we must have more mental health counselors at schools, but especially in our junior and senior high schools. Presently, our counselors usually have between 400 to 500 kids on their caseload. So if you're a counselor with, say, 400 students on your caseload, and one in four students has a mental health issue, can you really see 100 kids today, 100 kids on a one-to-one basis in a seven-hour day? The only person I can think of who can do this is Harry Potter, but he's a fictional character. Finally, our bullying laws must be strengthened. Bullying may cause our young Virginia citizens to commit suicide. In addition, it will cause these individuals to have mental health issues, ranging from depression, anxiety, eating disorders, and psychosis. Please, please pass Peyton's law. With this law, a bully will have all their bullying incidents reported to the transfer school. The awareness can help our schools deal more swiftly and effectively with bullying incidents if we know who the bullies are. We take our pride in our motto, Virginia is for lovers. Let's follow up this with Virginia Freezes Bullying and supports mental health training for all students and teachers and professionals in all schools. I look forward to making Virginia support to help my dream become a reality. And thank you so much for your time.
And thank you very much for speaking, John. Aaron Morris from, Senator McPike.
I just want to thank everyone from the Peyton's Project. I lost my brother, junior in high school, to suicide 16 years ago. And frankly, we haven't made a lot of progress since I lost my brother. The ratios are still poor, the support is not there, and we have a lot still to do. So I really appreciate your advocacy.
I think we're all very, very moved and impressed by your courage. Thank you. Eric Mark from PRTC. Hello, Eric. Good to see you. Followed by Jordan Boser from Westridge's SNR Club.
Thank you, Delegate Lingamfelter. Good afternoon. I am Eric Marks, and I'm the Interim Executive Director of the Potomac and Rappahannock Transportation Commission. I'd like to thank the delegation for hosting this forum, for allowing me to have the opportunity to speak, and for your involvement with and the support of my organizations. In particular, let me thank Senator Parker and Delegates Anderson and Miller, who serve on my board. Thank you. This past year, PRTC celebrated its 30th anniversary of serving the Prince William area, initially with commuter bus service to the DC Employment Corps, then with VRE rail service, followed by the introduction of local bus. PRTC has been and continues to be a regional and national leader in implementing innovative and efficient services, incorporating high technologies, and is considered a model when it comes to private sector contracting. In the 2000s, PRTC grew significantly to help meet demand for transit services for those seeking an alternative to increasingly congested roadways and others who had no alternative to access education, employment, and health care. However, growth came to an abrupt halt when our primary source of funding, the 2.1% motor fuels tax, was cut in half. Coupled with the loss of federal funding over the past several years, PRTC has had to cut service by over 20% and raise fares 37%, despite Prince William County shifting half of its NVTA 30% funding from roads to transit. Additionally, PRTC's member jurisdictions have had to put on hold or eliminate planned capital projects to ensure adequate revenue to pay for VRE. We're facing an interesting dilemma in Prince William. Despite large cuts, fare increases, and Prince William shifting over $6 million from roads to transit, we still face a $2+ million annual shortfall. Having reduced services so much already, additional cuts will bring much pain across the board and yield increasingly lower rates of return. Yet we were incredibly fortunate that the Commonwealth truly understands that providing attractive alternatives to driving alone is essential in Northern Virginia. By funding transportation management plans that complement a network of express toll facilities, the Commonwealth relieves Prince William and other localities from much of the burden of keeping up with increased needs for commuter services. However, the instability and inadequacy of the motor fuels tax revenue stream threatens the existence of currently operated commuter and local services, and the looming capital funding cliff threatens safety and reliability by not replacing transit vehicles in a timely manner. All we have to do is look at Metro to see what happens to those situations. What good will new services do if we can't sustain core operations? The region also needs to consider the consequences of not conforming to air quality requirements, which could put federal funds at risk. Compared to many places in America, we are in an enviable position to offer affordable housing, low taxes, and suburban lifestyle, attributes which are expected to bring significant growth to Prince William over the next 15 years. However, the inability to maintain transit services that ease congestion and make our region more accessible threatens to stunt this growth. Thank you all and for your consideration of the
subject. Thank you. I'm sure we're going to be visiting with you down at the restaurant. I think you're going to come back and be seeing all of this.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Okay. Mr. Gordon Cruiser from the West Ridge Swim and Recreation Club, and followed by Remy Simon. With a name like Lingamfelter, you figure I can pronounce your buddy's name. I'm challenged, I think. Yes, ma'am, please step up.
Good afternoon. My name is Remy Simon, and I'm a volunteer district captain for District 31 and District 36 for the Convention of States Project. Opponents of the Article 5 Convention have repeatedly claimed that the convention would run away or unilaterally impose radical constitutional changes on America. The Washington Post wrote an article in October of 16 that contended that it could widen the political divisions and jeopardize cherished rights and freedoms. By fear-mongering and dangling the moral prospects of losing our rights with supposedly no checks and balances in place, the naysayers want to shut this down before it even gets started. Opponents have since rallied around a new set of arguments, claiming that Congress, not the states, will control any Article 5 convention. Since the 80s, the conservative and liberal establishment, together with the special interest lobbyists, have blocked all constitutional efforts to address federal dysfunction. This disinformation campaign was started, and its participants included members of Congress who feared that a convention might propose amendments to limit their power. Today, we have Senate and House Democrats that have served over 50 years, and Republicans for over 44 years. It seems that we the people are being kept out of this, though our elected representatives, through our elected representatives, when these very words are which the Constitution of the United States begins. Over the years, since it was adopted, the Constitution has been amended 24 times. Why then is it to propose to call an Article 5 convention to propose amendments considered such a radical and dangerous act to prevent federal overreach and abuse? Is it better to have the Constitution amended by de facto 5-4 by the Supreme Court, unilaterally by the President, or by administrative rulings by anonymous bureaucrats? Another argument is that the process enables a tiny minority of Americans to amend the Constitution against the majority. Fearmongers also note that every state would have two votes and could approve amendments by simple majority. In that case, 26 of the less populous states with less than 18% of the nation's population could approve broad changes and send them to the states for ratification. I ask you, why would we spend our extra time away from our families to overthrow the Constitution? Ratification will give the states' representatives information on what their constituents would like to propose and add to the Constitution. There is nothing that would be adopted without the ratification of 38 states. 38 states must approve and ratify the amendment proposed by the convention. Voting for Virginia to participate in the Article 5 convention will fix what federal politicians do not have the political courage to do. We ask you to support HJ 547, and thank you, Delegate Scott Lingamfelter, for all your support.
Thank you very much for your remarks. Miss, I think, just to make sure, did I miss Gordon Boozer? Was he here or not? He is not here. Terry Well, he was at the wheel, and followed by Eileen Paul.
Good
I thank everybody for being prompt. You've been very respectful of everybody's time. I think my colleagues and I would agree, if we could get everybody to behave that way and rush for life, we'd be in the right. Okay, who's next?
I'm sorry.
This is for all, is that correct? Okay. Glad to hear from you, ma'am. Glad you're here.
I'm gonna read fast. Good afternoon. Thank you for the opportunity to speak to you today. My name is Paul. I'm here on behalf of Friends of Quantico Bay. Quantico Bay is the tidal wide border of Quantico Creek, which begins in Prince Forest Park, continues through the town of Dumfries, broadening into Quantico Bay in Prince William County before entering the Potomac River. I'm a resident of the 36th Senate District, served by Senator Surovell, and the 2nd Delegate District, served by Delegate Dudenham. Although there are many other issues in our area, the primary focus of Friends of Quantico Bay is and has been the recreational use of water for boating of all kinds. Our issue is the growth of invasive species hydrilla, which is choking Quantico Bay. Initially, it's seen as a benefit as it tends to clear the water, but as it grows, it captures the silt from runoff and makes use of the water very difficult. Kind of a general history, in 1986, a multi-year mechanical harvesting program of hydrilla was signed by the U.S. Corps of Engineers, the District of Columbia, Maryland, Virginia, and Metropolitan Council, Washington Council of Government, to focus on commercial or high recreational use. Use of herbicides and other control practices were ruled out. In 1987, it was first harvested in Virginia in the Alexandria and Fairfax areas. 1990, I received a letter from Cobb acknowledging our report of a problem in Quantico Creek Bay. Site inspection indicated hydrilla in the vicinity of piers and the mouth of the bay. 1991, there was no state funding. 1994, it was harvested in Stafford, Virginia. In 1999, it was found in the headwaters along the shore of Quantico Bay. In 2000, we made a request to the chairman of Cobb. It was not included in the Virginia budget. In 2007, we met with a COG representative and we took the group on a tour. In 2007 and 2008, it was harvested two times to open the channel. In 2009, there was no state funding. In May 2009, Friends of Quantico Bay was formed. In the years since that time, we've held many meetings, organized boat tours, reached out to the wider community, contacted many elected officials, attended the State Invasive Species Working Advisory Group meeting as guests, spoke at hearings held by the Secretary of Natural Resources in Richmond, because hydrilla is a statewide issue, appeared at the town of Dumfries meeting asking for their assistance and gathered information from across the country. What am I saying? We need your help. We are not getting anything done. I do thank Senator Surovell and Delegate Schudenheffer who are aware and are trying to assist. The long-term solution would be dredging of the bay, which would be very expensive, especially where there are no commercial marinas and only a small group of direct waterfront owners. There are commercial fishermen and bass boat users of the bay. The request by members of Friends of Quantico Bay is that funding be put in place for harvesting once again to open up the channel for recreational use. I know that it is thought that harvesting just spreads the hydrilla, and I agree. However, it now covers the entire bay, so that is why the members are requesting funding for the mechanical harvesting to open the channel once again. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much for being here. Janine Louder, followed by Daniel Foos. If I have somehow skipped over you and you have not been called, will you please make yourself known to somebody? Make yourself known to that nice lady back there so I can make sure you get her. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. My name is Jeannie Louder and I live in Gainesville, Virginia. I am with the Prince William Committee for Quality Education, but we are very closely associated with the effort to recall Ryan Sawyer, who is the chairman of our school board. Now, you might ask, why did I get involved with this? I'm not really usually involved with this effort, but it is because of the non-discrimination policy 060 that I became very involved with this. You might have noticed these darling children that came into the back of the room just before I spoke. I'm here on the behalf of my children. I'm here on the behalf of thousands of children in the Prince William County School system. And I come to you not just as a mother, but I come to you because I am a mental health professional. And I have worked with children who have been sexually abused and who have been emotionally abused and physically abused. And my concern with the non-discrimination policy is that those children will regress and that they will go back to behaviors that they have been involved with as a result of the abuse that they suffered. Now, I understand it's really hard to come out and put my head on the chopping block. I recognize each of you, you put your head on the chopping block multiple times on different issues. But this is a very big concern for a lot of parents in our county. And as I was going forth with the recall effort, it was very apparent to me that this goes across party lines. And I'm speaking to you because I recognize that in the next couple of months, you have several bills that are coming before you. And I want you to know, this is not a Republican or a Democratic issue. This is an issue with parents wanting to protect their children and understanding also that there are parents on the other side who have children who are struggling with their gender identity and they need help and compassion and ways that they can be handled in the school system. So I'm not coming to you with a bigoted viewpoint as has been used for a lot of people who have these concerns, but I have concerns about safety and privacy of our children. Now, my daughter, when she was speaking to several of her friends, said they also have concerns. I recognize my time's almost up, but I really beseech you as legislators and as representatives of the people to understand that people want safety for their children. And they want you to listen to both sides of the story. Thanks for your time.
Thank you very much. Daniel Foos, followed by Kevin Allen. Foos? Mr. Allen? Mr. Dean, now, I apologize. Potomac Riverkeepers? Great organization. Where are they? Dean? Alcox?
He's not here.
Okay. Jonathan Boosley? Ed, glad you're here. I was running out of names rapidly.
There's something else we could think to do today. But thank you. I'm an attorney. I've been trying for years to get people to pay attention to improvements in the courts, make them less cumbersome, less burdensome and expensive. And I want to... There's not time to get into much detail here. You have a very short session and supposedly part-time, but I want to ask you just to try to really be sensitive to the fact that you go to such lengths to pass a law, and then it goes out in the real world and into the courts. And I just ask that you take it very seriously, that it matters what happens to all of your work when it gets out there. And I don't know if you get notified when there's an interpretation of your statute or predecessor statutes, but I would hope that automatically when the Supreme Court or Court of Appeals interprets what your work is, that you would get a summary. There's lots of other cases that don't involve that, but something. I had a case dropped for a client on Tuesday because someone stopped to turn right and there was a car in front of them. And the prosecutor agreed and says, it's not clear in the statute. Do you have to stop again? Because the guy, two cars stopped, and the prosecutor just said, well, I'm gonna drop the case because it's not clear in the statute. I don't know if anybody tells you, you know, maybe that needs to be looked at, that kind of thing. So I hope you would take it very, very seriously. I think the legislation could be a lot less expensive if things were streamlined and everything, and I hope that it really does matter what your work, what's done with your work once it gets out into the regular society. I'll be able to look at that. Thanks.
Thank you very much, sir. Grace White? I see Ms. White is hustling down to the front.
Hustling down, yes.
Be door number one, door number two, or door number three. Take your time. Yes, ma'am. Welcome and glad you're here.
Thank you.
I appreciate the opportunity. I had not planned to speak today, so I do not have prepared remarks for to distribute to each of you. First, I would like to add my support for the redistricting reform that's been spoken about before, and also to note that this is an idea that has had bipartisan support in the Virginia State Senate, has passed every year for year after year after year in the Virginia Senate on a bipartisan basis. And I would ask that, and it has not, I believe, come to the floor for a floor vote in the House of Delegates. So I would ask that it at least get out of committee and get to the floor to have a floor vote for redistricting reform. The other reason I decided to sign up is I didn't see anyone signed up to talk about energy. And I regard clean energy as one of the most important issues in our state. Virginia is consistently listed by the American Council for an Energy Efficient Economy in the bottom third, bottom quarter of the states in terms of its energy policies. One reason is that the renewable energy portfolio for utilities is voluntary rather than being mandatory. The solar energy, wind energy, geothermal energy, all of those are important to our future. And it's changing rapidly. I just saw recently where Washington at DuPont Circle now has a sidewalk installed that generates electricity from pedestrians walking over. Think about that in a place like Union Station or in airports where there's 24/7 people walking around creating energy. It's a totally different kind of renewable energy. There's the battery technologies have improved, solar costs have dropped. There's also gym equipment that can generate energy if you're cycling. I've seen where gyms have offered discounts to their memberships, depending on how much energy they generate for the gym. In Virginia, you could be sued for violating the utility's monopoly power if you did that, because the legislature has not made it clear that power purchase agreements are not a violation of monopoly power. So I urge you to give attention to these. I know there's been a special subcommittee named on energy. I believe it's only met twice. But I would hope that it would bring some of these issues to light and that the legislature will act on them in the coming session.
Thank you, Ms. Lawrence. Mr. Ed Hyken?
Thank you, Mrs. White. Ms. Ed Hyken? Mr. Bowden? Yes, sir. What's your issue?
And you, I'm sorry, I was a little bit late. So my issue, as you folks get ready to go to down to Richmond in the coming weeks, there's a number of issues I could talk about. I could talk about healthcare. I could talk about any number of issues that other folks talk about, education, bullying, the environment. But I'm here to talk today about transportation because that really is a hub that many of those things are spokes to. Transportation here, especially in Northern Virginia, is something that everyone talks about a lot. You know, you have folks, especially in Crystal and Pine, where most folks, they go up to the Beltway. They either go to Arlington, D.C., Alexandria, you name it. And most of those folks, on average, spend, an hour and a half to 2 hours every day going and then coming back. You factor that in with a normal workday, about 8 hours, looking at 12 hours that folks here are spending away from their families, away from their kids, away from being productive in their jobs and in their daily lives. That is an issue. We've spoken about bullying, we've spoken about all these other issues that children have. Well, if their parents are spending so much time on the road and outside of the household, they're not able to help handle these issues that they have. If folks are spending so much time on the road consuming gas, creating more pollution, that affects the environment. If folks are spending so much time just sitting in traffic, they start to become distracted. They text. They might call someone. They might be doing something they shouldn't be doing. I know at least two of you have sort of championed, raising penalties for people who are distracted driving. And so, that in that way, transportation isn't just a luxury or anything like that. It's a public safety issue. It's a health issue. It's a parental aid issue. And so, in that way, I hope that all of you, as you go back to Richmond this month, look at it in that light. Because I know that funding is tight. I know there's a shortfall. I know there are other things that take priority. However, because transportation touches so many different things and so many aspects of our lives here in Prince William County, that you prioritize it that way. And that you look at it in a light where if you are able to appropriate that money properly, start looking at things like light rail, bus rapid transit, even biking, helping those commuter lots, things like that, you'll really improve the lives of your constituents. So I hope you'll keep that in mind. I'll appreciate talking to all of you about that later. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Cantlin?
Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
What's your issue?
My name is Monson Ron Kala, and I'm resident of the county in Gainesville, Virginia. My issues vary from transportation to social justice. I'm here to protest a House Bill 1612 along with 1667, which are both sponsored by Delegate Bob Marshal, who is my current delegate. Delegate, I'm here to submit to you that these are very discriminatory bills.
Excuse sir, would you address all of us?
It's
very important that this not be an A-B thing.
Oh, no, I didn't mean to.
From you. And
I wanted
so
to.
If you want to keep it on that plane, I appreciate it.
Yes, Delegate. House Bill 1612, which is a misnomer, it's introduced as a Physical Privacy Act, which actually infringes upon the privacy of the LGBTQ community, and is really a misnomer and does not help anybody in any way. My second issue is of transportation. I want to look back towards the past 20 years and say that 28 could have been a better project when it was built, or over the years when our very respected leaders are in those offices of change, but those changes were not made while those changes should have been made before such production has been happening around that route. One of the last things I want to talk about as a business owner of Gainesville Transport, we run GBWR 80,000 pound gross weight vehicle rating trucks across country, and they run across country and they don't run in Virginia because our contracts are not in Virginia, and Virginia's grocery products are usually local rather than national. So all the trucking companies who are homed here in Prince William County are actually paying a personal property tax on their commercial vehicles. And I think everybody, this is a nonpartisan issue, that you shouldn't be paying a personal property tax on a commercial vehicle. They're being rated right now as a T license plate when it comes to taxes, which you actually get that license plate when you're buying a pickup truck. But these license plates are actually apportioned, and those are not personal license plates, they're commercial license plates. So on the average, just to give a little perception, one truck nets around $25,000 a year, and the tax on that is $4,500. So it's a big portion of any truck owner's income that's going towards a misnomer tax. Now, if these trucks would be taken off personal property tax and a business property tax would be unveiled, we would welcome that. But a personal property tax on a commercial vehicle just doesn't make sense. So I thank you guys for that time, and I thank you guys for hosting this town hall. It's much appreciated and much needed. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And Mr. Dan Morrow, please. Tomorrow, welcome. And our last speaker will be Kevin Allen. Mr. Allen, thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Thank you for being here.
I'm here to plead with you to help Prince William County and Governor McCullough to push back the permit for Dominion Power solid waste permit. I live down there on Boston Point Road. They've poisoned us. They've denied it. They've dumped 27 million gallons of poison in our backyard. It took them 7 months to acknowledge that they knew this, and they acknowledged it. Senator Surovell has pushed to have monitoring wells established around their perimeter to show their contamination, and it has now shown their contamination has pushed into our properties. They are now offering to supply fresh water to the community, and back in April when we spoke, we encouraged them to do this, and they announced that they would never do that. That would be a sign of guilt, and they weren't guilty. Well, now they're saying they're wanting to help us because these well tests are showing that the poison's got outside their property. The liner that this pond D is made out of a clay-based liner, which is not a very good liner. They're saying that this coal ash facility is safe. It's not safe. It's leaching out into the water. It's leaching into the Potomac River. We just asked the Prince William County to push Dominion to have the beaver pond tested, the core sample in the beaver pond the weekend before Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving weekend, the beaver pond got drained. So I brought it to their attention. They said the wind did it. So I find it very hard to believe that Dominion is a good neighbor. They're non-truthful. They've offered to pay water for the residents there only after they pay for it themselves, that they would reimburse them. If the people there could afford to stop drinking poison, they would have done it already. I've done it. I just got through doing it. It cost me $40,000 to put water in my house. I had no choice because the pipes were bursting. I had to move my family out of the house. My children live somewhere else now. And I'm here to help, to hope that you guys will push Prince William County and Governor McCullough to do something about this and not let Dominion Power plant all that poison out there just to leach out into the Potomac River. There's other ways. North Carolina, South Carolina all require their power companies to put it in a modern, safe landfill. Virginia does not. They're looking the other way. The EPA is looking the other way. Nobody's watching the ball. Senator Cervello's on our side helping us, helping me have the nerve to stand up here and try to speak for the people down there that the children are drinking this poison, still drinking this poison. And Dominion is denying it. Prince William County is not, they're acknowledging that our wells are poisoned, but not acknowledging why. Well, when you have these elements of carcinogenic lead, hexavalent chromium, boron, strontium, all these elements that are poison, they know it's poison. They've met with us, but they still fail to go up against Dominion Power, and I believe it's because Dominion Power is too strong, and I'm hoping you guys can push legislation to help this and keep us all safe. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Kevin Allen.
Hello, my name is Kevin Allen. I'm here on behalf of myself and my wife who wasn't able to join us today. I'm here to urge you to support the pain-capable Child Protection Act. Unborn babies, their heart begins beating about 3 weeks. Brainwaves are detected about 8 weeks, and science has already proven that they can feel pain at 20 weeks. The least we can do for these unborn children is to protect them from feeling the pain of abortion. Abortions at 20 weeks are violent, they're brutal, and I urge you to support HB 1473, the Pain Capable Unborn Child Protection Act. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And first of all, let's just give yourself a round of applause for being very respectful for everybody who's had a chance to meet you. Opportunity to thank personally Senator Scott Surovell and his staff for the work that they did in helping to put this together, and Delegate Rich Anderson and his work in helping to put this together. I'm very, very grateful to both of these gentlemen. It means a lot to us to hear what you have to say. Now, what I'd like to do, if you would bear with us, is give each of the members here an opportunity to maybe share the top couple of things that they're going to be focused on this year, and then I propose we all go home and see our grandchildren. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay. We'll start with Senator McPike.
Thank you all for attending. If you have not picked it up, we do have some of the copies of legislative agenda and bills proposed this year. As you can imagine, we've heard a lot today, but a lot of items that are important to us, we can't necessarily be the primary patron, but we actually work together. So you'll see sometimes that others will co-patron or support or vote in support of other things in relation to these issues. I will be carrying some bills in relation to the suicide prevention and some of the bullying that you've heard earlier in relation to the efforts that Peyton Freeze's family has been putting forward, as well as for extending our foster kids program and their access to health care. Last year we did, I think, the right thing, extended the opportunity for kids in foster care from 18 to 21, 22, to afford an opportunity for education and other support infrastructure that did not extend necessarily to health care in terms of automatic enrollment. So we're doing some corrective things on that. Veterans benefits, some veterans grant opportunities. This area's significant veterans population. We continue to take a look at that. Protect our funding for education. We do have a revenue shortfall that we are working through diligently. Although I think Senator Barker is very optimistic. I think we'll wait until we get there and actually see some of the numbers. And then a number of other items in relation to transportation and consumer fairness. I received a number of complaints in relation to high lanes not being able, notifying folks if there's an accident versus just posting $25, $15, $20 pricing. So there's no informed consumer choice right now whether $12 is good or bad in terms of your destination and your travel time. So we have some work to do to inform our consumers in that regard. So I know we have lots of other items, so thank you for the opportunity to hear from you today. It is important, and look forward to hearing from you again in the future.
Thank you. Senator Surovell.
Thank you, Governor Lingamfelter. I also thank my colleagues for coming out today and for everybody for being here today. It is important to hear from you all. I'm going to introduce probably between 35 and 40 different pieces of legislation. I'm going to talk about two really quickly. One of which, two I want to talk about. One is, I've been working with Delegate Anderson actually over the last, I think, 3 years now on texting while driving. The bill I'm introducing this year is to try and make Virginia a hands-free state. I represented the families about 4 years. I'm also an attorney. About 4 years ago, a family whose 18-year-old son was killed by a texting driver on Route 7 in Fairfax County. A guy, my client's son, ran out of gas, had his car on the side of the road, had his hat on, was pushing his car off the road, and he got hit by somebody at 60 miles an hour who had 1,000 feet of clear road in front of him, never braked. And when they did a forensic of his phone, he still had been texting all the way from when he left his ex-wife's house all the way where he struck my client and killed him. And any of you who drive on 95 at Beltway or anywhere, all you have to do is look at the cars next to you and everybody's got their phone in their hand and looking at it. It's completely out of control. And our current law is not enforceable. It's not workable. If you ask any police officer, he'll tell you can't convict anybody for anything because all they got to do is say they were playing Angry Birds and they're not guilty. The only people that are convicted are people that admit to it. So. I'm hopeful we can pass that this year. I'm pretty sure I can get out of the Senate. I'm hopeful I can get out of the House. I know Ben Rich is going to work hard to make that happen if he can, and as will other people here. But it's a real, I think, a crisis. And for the first time in 50 years last year, auto fatalities were up between January 1 and June 30. And they attribute that to distracted driving. First time in 50 years in the United States of America, more people died in auto accidents. Second thing I'm just going to mention really quick, we're hearing Prince William, heard from Mr. Morrow talk about coal ash. I'm going to have three different bills on the coal ash. One I'm going to talk about, though, is to require utilities in Virginia to recycle coal ash. Last year, Virginia imported 600 container loads of coal ash from China. You might ask, why would we be importing coal ash from China? But it's actually, they use it to make concrete. It serves the same purpose as Portland cement, and because we don't burn coal in Virginia anymore, or a whole lot of it at least, because we've switched over to natural gas, they have to go to China to get it. And in North Carolina, South Carolina, and Georgia, what they're doing is they're recycling the coal ash that's in the ground, and then using that for concrete fixing. And you know, it allows us to not only not make jobs in China, we can make jobs here, we can clean up the environment at the same time. And I'm hopeful that that bill will pass. It seems pretty common sense to me, but I'm not really clear where Dominion and APCO are two investor-owned utilities stand on it. But I'm hopeful that if we pass that, we can at least start cleaning up the coal ash that's poisoning Mr. Morrow and all the folks down at Fossum Point's water. We'll see. So that's two of the things I'm working on. Thanks for being here again.
Thank you. Senator Mark.
Thank you all very much for being here. It's a great turnout. Senator Surovell and I were at a different public hearing earlier today, and people were saying, well, is anybody going to show up because of the snow? This is a fantastic turnout and an indication of your involvement and investment in what we're doing in Virginia. Just quickly, two things that I'll be concentrating on this year. One is I am a member of the Deeds Commission that's been dealing with mental health services in Virginia for the last 3 years. We have a number of recommendations that are coming forward this year. The governor has proposed funding several of them, but I think we will be able to go much beyond that and fund additional ones. We're going to make a major investment in mental health services, and I think there's a strong commitment to continuing to do that after this year. On a bipartisan basis. So it's not a partisan issue. There's a very strong support from both Republicans and Democrats on that. One other major thing I'm going to be working on this year is I'm carrying the legislation in the Senate to establish the Metro Safety Commission, which is critically needed given some of the safety issues that Metro's had over the last several years and the loss of confidence in the system, partly as a result of that. We need to fix that. We need to make sure we're protecting the riders. We need to make sure we're enhancing the credibility of the system and making sure that, that we can benefit from the system that certainly has the potential to get back to where it was at one time when over 90% of the operating costs of the Metro Rail system were funded by fares because it was a popular, well-run system, and we need to fix that. And as just a quick shout out to Eric Marks there with the BRTC. We need a variety of different systems. We have BRTC working well here, and part of what can make it work best is having the connections to a strong Metro system.
Russian rapid transit.
Okay.
Delegate Marshall.
You know, everybody who asks me to put in legislation thinks that their legislation is number one, so I'm not going to argue with them, but in the interest of time, let me highlight just some of these. We had the episode earlier this year of a difficulty in selecting a replacement for a member of the school board who was called to active duty. I frankly didn't like the way it was handled, but in order to avoid that in the future, I made it very clear in a bill that I've introduced that the school board must accept the recommendation of someone who is a member of the school board and called to active duty. If they submit one, they must accept that one. If they submit a list, they must pick from the list so as to avoid what we had this year. I hope that does that. I've got several bills dealing with protection of personal privacy from government snooping. If a policeman wears a body camera and doesn't turn it on and there's no emergency for not turning it on, it instructs a jury that while they may accept the oral testimony, they may want to give a different weight to it from whether or not the body camera is on. We've got a license plate bill limiting the time at which the police may keep this information. I have another bill that says that the DMV, except with a warrant, cannot go profiling your DMV picture for any such purposes. I do have a measure dealing with a study on the long-term effects of marijuana use. And I've done that because an effort by Republican Majority Leader and a Democrat Senator from Tidewater want to decriminalize it. I find this very problematic medically. I've got two top researchers who've assisted me. One is a psychiatrist who treats people with this kind of drug dependence. Another from John Hopkins, who is just a premier in this area. You may not know this, but the pot that was used in the 1960s had from 3 to 5% THC component. Now, it is from 13 to 30% THC. And this led Maureen Dowd, a writer for the New York Times, when she went out to Colorado and ate one of these cookies, to fall over and thought she was dead, and nobody was telling her that she was dead. Again, it also weakens the heart muscle. It can lead to Alzheimer's because it cuts off blood to the brain. It increases suicide and a bunch of things like that. I have another study, which I hope my colleague will support, on heroin. I've done a survey, for example, in Loudoun, every sheriff over there, of course, the sheriff carries this naloxone. In Prince William County, nobody here is naloxone who's a policeman, so I want to deal with that. On this question of the schools, right now it is illegal for a boy to go into a girl's locker room. It is illegal for you on I-95, if you're a man, to go into the ladies' room. If you're at a state park and you're a guy and going into the girls' room, you're going to get in trouble. That's the status quo. Why some people insist on calling this bigotry or bias, I have the slightest idea. It's simply common sense to me. I just don't think it's the smartest thing in the world to have 16-year-old boys in a changing room with naked 15-year-old girls on the swim team. Why that has to be a problem, I don't know. I have one more measure which I hope to garner support across the board, declaring pornography as a public health hazard. When you are a guy watching pornography and you are called to a jury and you do this, you're much less likely to convict for sexual assault. And if you convict, you're much more likely to have a light sentence than a serious sentence. In an article in the Washington Post detailing this bill indicated that Senator Barbara from Lola was going to take a favorable look at this, and I welcome support from across the political spectrum. I thank you for being allowed to serve you, and I have a list of some of the bills that I've introduced if you want to talk to me afterwards. Thank you.
Delegate Anderson.
Thank you, Delegate Lingamfelter. Thanks all of you for being here today. Just very quickly, I am going to carry a bill which attempts to address this very real danger of distracted driving. Senator Surovell's approach is to do a hands-free requirement through a Bluetooth device. My approach is going to be, because I do have some concerns that may have rust sledding in the house, is to do a measure that would establish a fourth category of adverse driving practices, which is called distracted driving. Right now, there are three categories in the Code of Virginia. One is reckless driving, the other is aggressive driving, the third is improper driving. We want to create this fourth category of distracted driving, and the bill will have a number of provisions that will define that and some associated fine structures. So we'll see whichever happens. Actually, I prefer a hands-free bill myself. I'm just concerned about the potential for making it through the House. The second bill that I'm going to carry out of about 12, I'm not carrying 40 bills, is that to address for our professional firefighters who now are not covered for colorectal cancer, which is a very prevalent form of cancer in our firefighting community, who gets exposed to certain agents in the firefighting business. And so we tried to carry that before this year. I'm going to carry that on behalf of firefighters. Like I say, I have about 12 bills, but my real focus will be on the military and veterans community in Virginia, since I chair the Military and Veterans Caucus along with Senator Bryce Reeves. That takes quite a bit of our time. That caucus is the clearinghouse for our military and veterans legislation. We have 800,000 veterans in Virginia and 47,000 in Prince William County alone. So that will command quite a bit of my attention. So thank you for being here today.
Thank you.
Thanks again, everybody, for coming out today, and to my colleagues, it was an honor to share this panel with you. A couple of bills. I'll have a full slate. 15 is a full slate for us in the House this year on a variety of different subjects to try to save
money. We're more efficient in the House.
Brevity is the essence of wit, one step. So 15 is a good number. I'll try to do things on education. I'm going to do things in transportation, the economy. A couple of bills I will point out. I already mentioned opioids. We'll be carrying a bill, and Senator Dunnevant, Dr. Dunnevant, on the Senate side will carry the companion bill, and it's to limit the amount of prescription to 3 days in an emergency room for an opioid. And this has been a real problem where people who are addicted will go to emergency rooms and often get up to a 90-day supply. Very dangerous, and frankly, someone could be addicted after 30 days. So then by the time they're done with that prescription, already addicted, and or if they're shopping for a prescription after they're already addicted, going to the emergency room is often the easiest place to do it. The other thing on this one is it takes the pressure off the emergency room doctors who have actually physically been threatened. Police have to respond to this. When addicted individuals are in the emergency room, what they really need is drug treatment. but they're threatening the doctor for that prescription. And frankly, by passing this bill, it will take the heat off of the emergency room doctor. If somebody needs to be the bad guy, we can be the bad guy. And respond and say that you can only get 3 days and then follow up with your family's doctor. The other thing I'll say on this is when that 90-day supply gets out, sometimes people might take a day or two of the pill and realize it doesn't agree with them. And then it's a risk having that medication in the home. And people break into homes or addicted folks will seek out those drugs. So I put out the public message now in Prince William and Loudoun County and surrounding counties. We have collection means for this. If you have those expired prescriptions or unused, please destroy them, turn them in, get rid of them, because it is a hazard.
And do not please flush them down the toilet. I'm serious, because it goes into the watershed in the Chesapeake Bay, and it has a very adverse effect in the water. Just thought I'd throw that out there as a member of the marvelous Chesapeake Bay Commission. Go ahead.
Thank you for that. That's absolutely, I mean, I don't know if we have the collection bags out there, but I think they're readily available here and we can get those. But if anybody has a need for that, we can make that happen for you. The last one I want to mention is cybersecurity. This is something I've actually dealt with several of my constituents with over the past year. A number of cybersecurity blackmail issues over Facebook and other things, and I'm working with the Attorney General on that. We need to do some things about that because people are being harassed and blackmailed without doing anything wrong. People can easily, from other countries, get pictures off Facebook and then harass people and blackmail them. This is unfortunately becoming a problem, and it is invading into families' privacy and also is causing issues that even go into the tragic area of bullying. So thank you. It's a pleasure and honor to serve, and thank you again for coming out today.
Thank you. One final thing, I'll just mention a couple of things. This is a remarkable delegation that I'm serving with. I've been doing this now for 16 years. Bob is our senior member. He's been doing it for what, since the Civil War? Since the Revolutionary War, he was there. Memphis was founded. But you've got really devoted citizen legislators who really do a lot of tag teaming. I mean, Jeremy has been all over this colorectal piece, and I have, and so is Rich. We work across the aisle for what's best for the community. We really do that. George and I work together on budget issues, and mostly we just have headaches over budget issues, but we do work very hard to do that right and to represent the entire community. And so at a time when everybody's talking about Republicans and Democrats and Libertarians and Flat Earth Society and all this stuff, I think that this delegation really is exemplary in my personal view. Let me tell you a couple of things I'm going to do. Last year we did get the Foster 21 thing done. I worked that very hard. I'm glad to hear that Jeremy's picking up the ball on this. You have to be so careful. You know, when someone's in foster care and they're done at 18, they are not ready. I mean, all the mentoring goes away when they hit the street. And so this was the rationale behind doing this, and I'm glad we got that done. I've got a bill this year that I really hope we can get passed, and that is a requirement that agencies look at 10% of their regulations every year, such that over a 10-year period, they will have looked in a very disciplined manner at 100% of them. We put some principles in statute that say what ought to drive the development of a regulation. It ought to be in plain English. It ought to be truly something that needs to be regulated, not just every jot and tittle, but really put some thought in it before you put the expense on the public to do that. So I'm going to bring that measure. I hope to get a lot of support for it. And I think that if we do it right, don't fall down, you might actually see some regulations go away. We, of course, are going to be working on the budget. We start with about a $1.5 billion shortfall that we have to work on. I think we're in much better shape today, wouldn't you agree, George, than we were 4 months ago? We're getting some fairly optimistic numbers on what's happening with the economy, and hopefully we'll get back to the days when we don't have to scrap to fund all of our core responsibilities here in the Commonwealth. I'm going to be doing a lot of work in public safety. I chair the Public Safety Committee, so most of my life is caught not only in my bills, but everybody else's bills that come to my committee, and I chair the Subcommittee on Appropriations for Public Safety as well. So lots of work to do. Again, I want to thank all of you for honoring us with your trust.
We are citizen legislators, and like I like to say to people, the laws we write, we live under just like you, and when they're stupid, we suffer. And so we try to really make sure that we write laws that make sense, and that we don't pass the worst law ever, which is the law of unintended consequences. So thank you very much. Go visit your grandchildren.